Anne Robinson and Philip Schofield are your hosts for Test the Nation.
Live from Pinewood Studios, it's Test the Nation, Know Your Planet. And taking part in tonight's show, explorer who got caught short by an African buffalo, a cyclist who was rescued by Max Bygraves, the school rum who escaped from crocodiles, some World Cup singing builders, several members of parliament, and TV weather legend Michael Fish. Yes, Britain's biggest interactive test is back. Welcome your hosts, Anne Robinson and Philip Schofield.
Yes, hello, good evening. Thank you for joining us for a very special Test the Nation.
There are now 5.5 minutes to go before the test begins, so let me introduce you properly to our groups here in the studio. Would you please welcome our explorers? Don't forget, of course, we've got our lovely school run mum. This should be fun. The politicians! And they're very green because they are the cyclists. Tonight, will they get it right? It's the weather forecaster.
You need to take the test will be coming up on your screens. Just before we kick off, there's one group still to introduce. Will they know their planet better than anyone else? Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our celebs.
It's BBC presenter and all-round action man, Animal Parks' Ben Fogle. Hoping to bring some order to this house, it's Tory MP, Anne Winnicombe. Adding some fizz to the show, Coronation Street's Jenny McAlpine. Can he win it for the Welsh? Champion hurdler, Colin Jackson. He's not found it easy being green, but will he know more than everyone else? It's Dick Strawbridge. She's come all the way from the other side of the planet. Aussie comedian, Julia Morris. The actor with the biggest voice in show business, Brian Blessed. And hoping to do Northern Ireland proud tonight, welcome Blue Peter's Zoe Salmon.
And, of course, we'll be talking to our stars throughout this evening, but for just now, good luck. And finally, our experts here to guide us through life on planet Earth. Please welcome world-renowned zoologist and best-selling author Mark Carwardine. Now, for the last 2 decades, he's been photographing wildlife around the world. He's a besotted animal lover, so very attractive to us women. Mark, I understand you once spent 3 nights with a walrus. How was it for the walrus?
I never asked, actually. It was a bit embarrassing. I got a phone call to say that a walrus was sunbathing on a beach near Skegness, of all places. And I got involved in a madcap scheme to take this walrus, who obviously became known as Wally the Walrus, back to his home in the Arctic. And we ended up en route in Iceland, and I had to spend 3 days and 3 nights sleeping on the floor of an aircraft hangar next to Wally, getting up on the hour every hour to hose him down with freezing cold water.
Lucky walrus. Our second guru, Lucy Siegel, writes on all things green for The Observer. Now, she believes that green is now seen as very stylish and Sheik, and I'm told you're mad about composting.
Yes, I'm very excited about composting. I have a little Japanese composting system which I quite often carry with me to show people, so I take it on the tube and things like that, and it's very exciting to me.
But what about at home? How does it change your life at home?
Well, I can compost 70% of my household waste, which means I have very light bin bags, and I think it's just a very easy thing to do. I've also got a wormery which I've just got, so it's just getting better and better.
Thank you, Lucy. Rather more seriously, Mark, at this point, can I ask you about the earthquake in Indonesia? How much are we contributing to that sort of disaster happening?
Well, yeah, it's a terrible disaster this weekend, of course, for everybody in Java. I think an earthquake is one of the few things we can't be blamed for, actually, but it's interesting because many so-called natural disasters that we're told are natural disasters are actually caused by people or exacerbated by people. So earthquakes, one of the few exceptions.
Thank you. Philip.
Thanks very much indeed, Anne. Right, just before we start, you'll be seeing something tonight that you have never seen on Test the Nation before, because we've set a challenge to some of our studio audience, including our celebrities. We asked them to volunteer to travel to the studio in the most ecologically friendly way they could think of.
OK, Philip, how did you get here today?
Well, I thought I would lead by example. Here you go, have a look at this. My green battery-powered car. How about you, Annie?
I just got here as I always do, because I work at Pinewood a lot of days of the month, mm-hmm. like this. Colin Jackson, how it's really done.
Yes, Colin, she's got buttocks of steel, let me tell you. Now, some people here have really made the effort tonight, and later you'll see how our groups, including some of our celebs, rose to the challenge. Annie.
Now, on with the test. There are 65 questions in Know Your Planet. They're divided into five sections. Remember, you'll have to answer every question or your score won't add up. So, pens, pencils, specs at the ready. The Know Your Planet test is about to begin. Questions in the first section are about the remarkable wildlife that has made natural history programs so popular. Eight questions coming up. Clip first with each one, then you have 15 seconds to answer.
He can imitate the calls of at least 20 different species. He also, in his attempt to outsing his rivals, incorporates other sounds that he hears in the forest. That was a camera shutter. And that's a car alarm. And now the sounds of foresters and their chainsaws working nearby.
Question one. This bird is one of nature's great impressionists. What is it? Is it A, a minor bird, B, a lyre bird, C, a mockingbird, D, a who-do-you-do bird? Question two. That was from the Oscar-winning March of the Penguins. What type are they? Are they A, king, B, emperor, C, prince, or D, duke?
This is a beachmaster, and there are a dozen or so like him spaced out along this beach. Each one of them has his own harem, and I estimate that this one has about 100 females in his. And his sole object in life at the moment is to make quite sure that he and he alone mates with every single one of them. And for that, he must fight.
Question three, what's the name of this big-nosed seal? Is it A, elephant seal, B, proboscis seal, C, rhino seal, D, privy seal?
Her large paws give an excellent grip, and that long tail helps her balance. Silently, she positions herself above her prey.
Question four, film close-up for the first time on the BBC's Planet Earth. What is the name of this elusive cat? Is it A, Arctic lion, B, snow leopard, C, polar lynx, D, ice puma?
During summer, McNeil River Falls sees the biggest gathering of grizzlies in the world. For grizzly bears, it's an unmissable midsummer feast.
Question five. These grizzly bears are experts at catching which fish? A, trout, B, catfish, C, pike, D, salmon.
Some of the young have even taken to underwater swimming. They can stay down for more than 30 seconds and appear to do this just for fun.
Question six. On which continent would you find this monkey? A, Europe, B, Australia, C, North America, D, Asia. Question seven. At 168 miles an hour, this is the fastest bird in the world. What is it? A, golden eagle, B, peregrine falcon, C, kestrel, D, kite.
It's far bigger than even the biggest dinosaur. Its tongue weighs as much as an elephant. Its heart is the size of a car. And some of its blood vessels are so wide that you could swim down them. Its tail alone is the width of a small aircraft's wings.
Question eight, the biggest creature to have ever lived. What kind of whale is it? A, humpback, B, killer, C, sperm, D, blue. And that's the end of the first section. Philip.
So earlier you saw Anne and me arriving at our studio in our own very ecologically friendly way, but let's see how our groups here rose to the task. This is spectacular. A load of them took the challenge. Here's what happened. O'Callaghan. They're currently building Wembley Stadium. Let's talk first of all about your mode of transport there. How green are you guys? You all arrived. Look at that. You all arrived on the back of your very green truck. How green are you?
At home or here? At home or on this?
Well, both really. I mean, we know that you're green on the back of the truck, but what about at home? It's all well and good doing it for the telly.
Not really.
No?
No.
Is it something that bothers you? Something you're interested in?
No, not really.
No? Don't care about the planet? Don't give a stuff about the planet?
I don't care what I do, but I care about the planet as a whole.
Okay, that's good. And what about you?
Oh, yes, very, very much worried about what happens in the planet, planet warming, so forth. I'm a scuba diver, past and see what happens to the world. Mm. You can see it when you go down.
Let's just sort of get off the subject of ecology and being green for a second and talk about Wembley Stadium, seeing as you're here. The bookies have got 4-1 that it won't be ready for next year's cup final.
Let's put it really into perspective. This is the greatest stadium the world is ever going to see.
Yes.
The greatest football stadium, the greatest stadium ever.
Is it going to be ready?
We're going to deliver the greatest stadium you will ever see.
Is it going to be ready for the Olympics?
We will have it ready, and we will have the greatest stadium. And I'll tell you what, we'll make it the envy of the world.
Marvellous.
Yeah!
Well done, guys. Right. Over here to our explorers. And where's Mark? Matt Brazier. Hello, Mark. Now, let's have a look at the way you arrived this evening, because this can't be easy. This is all right, well and good if you're on the ice, I would have thought, but this is particularly difficult on a road.
It was particularly tricky, and the dogs sort of seemed to go in a straight line, so it made kind of roundabouts a bit awkward.
Have you worked with dogs before?
Minimal. I mean, not really driven the dogs, they just such like that before, so it made it quite hard work.
They're famous dogs as well.
Yeah,
dogs.
The whole team worked on Tomb Raider.
And one of the dogs was Angelina Jolie's favourite.
Indeed, Olaf, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, do you know that you know your score? Should I tell you?
No. No.
I'm going to tell you mine because it's quite good. 7 out of 8 so far, so well done.
Very good.
Annie.
Brian, did you enjoy your trip? Brian, hello.
Hello, Anne.
Come
sorry,
on now, concentrate.
Sorry,
did you you're just looking at the explorers, aren't you?
Or
is it the pretty mums you're looking at? Did you enjoy your trip with Dick?
Enjoy my trip with who, Anne?
Dick!
Dick, a marvellous man. Well, it's, I mean, it's two heavyweights together. I mean, yeah. You know, two masculine lads together. I mean, but we had a marvellous trip together, yes. It taught me a great deal. I've been to the Eden Project, and it's absolutely fascinating. I want to say, by the way, builders, I used to be a plasterer. Yes! Gordon's alive! Sorry, Anne, go on. Yeah, go on, Anne.
No, but you're also 50% actor, 50% explorer, aren't
There's
you?
There's no end to my talent.
No. Anne Widdecombe, surprisingly, you've been to the Arctic, haven't you, to look at polar bears?
I don't know whether it's surprising, but I have been to the Arctic and I have seen a polar bear, yeah.
Why did you go there? What was the idea?
To see a polar bear.
Right. Was it part of a television programme? Were you filming it?
Was I what?
Filming it.
I wasn't filming it, no. I'm very poor with a camera.
How green are you?
I don't compost.
You don't compost. Jenny, how about Underworld, that wonderful factory in Corrie? Are you very green there?
We're not. I better get Mr. Baldwin onto it, really. We better get a green bin or whatever you have to do.
I don't think Mr. Baldwin's with you anymore.
No, but Danny Baldwin.
Danny Baldwin.
I call him Mr.
Okay.
Baldwin.
Back to the test of Section 2, The World About Us. These are questions about the power and scale of planet Earth and also some about the dangers that threaten the environment. The first 6 questions on the big wide world, 15 seconds to answer each one. Question 9, how old is planet Earth? 4.5 billion years, 4.5 million years, 4,500 years, 4.5 years. Question 10, a lost world with 40 new species was recently discovered on which Indonesian island? Borneo, Java, Sumatra, New Guinea.
Moving at 250 miles an hour, an avalanche destroys everything in its path.
Question 11. Which is the most dangerous type of snow avalanche? Powder, crevice, slab, or boulder?
The sheer physical power of the ocean dominates our planet. The great waves that roar in towards the shores are dramatic demonstrations of its power.
Question 12. Which is the largest ocean, covering more of the Earth's surface than the land does? The Atlantic, the Pacific, the Arctic, or the Indian? Question 13. What collided with Asia to create the Himalayas? A meteorite, an iceberg, a tidal wave, or India? Question 14. Where on Earth would you find the most geysers? Japan, Yellowstone Park, Alaska, or Walford? Okay, next 7 questions about our planet under pressure. 20 seconds to answer each, and let's start by putting a smile on everyone's face.
Now, my Shirley, like most women, uses hairspray, but she don't use an aerosol. Not anymore. You see, during the 1970s and 80s, aerosols were everywhere. And the gases from these harmless-looking cans floated up through the atmosphere and into the stratosphere, where they started knocking on heaven's door, creating a hole in the ozone layer. Now, the ozone layer protects you and me and all the little kiddies, God bless them, from the sun's harmful rays. The ones that burn your bunts. These rays are forever pouring through those holes. What up? What up? What up? We all love a tan, but no one likes skin cancer. So have a think and have a heart. Excuse me 1 minute, will you please? Shirley, don't do that, love. Shirley, we don't do that.
Question 15. Over which of these would you find the biggest hole in the ozone layer? Greenland, Los Angeles, Antarctica, or the Sahara?
Very striking when you sit as close to an orangutan as this to see how similar they are to human beings. We are both, of course, great apes. But look how human her hand is, the skill with which she picks things up. And oddly enough, the fact that she is clearly left-handed. Great apes share with human beings a predilection to use either the right hand or the left hand, and she's left-handed.
Question 16. Who or what represents the biggest threat to the orangutan's survival? Palm oil production, climate change, pollution, or peat burns? Question 17. A single flight to New York creates the same amount of carbon dioxide as the average car does in how long? A week, a month, a year, a decade?
This water shortage makes you realise how fragile life is, doesn't it? I mean, you always assume life will go on as it has, and then suddenly there's no water. Mm. It's like waking up one morning and finding there's no air.
Well, not really, Alice. Because if there was no air, you just wouldn't wake up, would you?
Well, right. You'd sleep right through. You know, till they put it back on again.
Question 18. When water restrictions were first introduced this year, what were you banned from doing with a hosepipe? Watering a garden? Topping up a hot tub, filling a pool, or cleaning a fish pond?
More than 250,000 people have been left homeless in Peru after severe flooding. The charity Christian Aid, which launches an appeal tomorrow, says the human cost is devastating.
Question 19. Which weather phenomenon caused these floods? El Nano, El Nino, El Nono, or El Cid? Question 20. Which has been the warmest decade worldwide since records began? The 1890s, the 1920s, the 1970s, or the 1990s? Question 21. Which of these is a major contributor to methane in the atmosphere? Petrol engines, refrigerators, nuclear reprocessing, or flatulent cows? And that's the end of section two. Philip.
These days, words like greenhouse gases and fossil fuels are very much part of our everyday language. But do people actually know what they mean? We thought we'd find out. So this afternoon, we sent Colin Jackson down to the canteen here at Pinewood to quiz our groups who were waiting to come into the studio. Were they clued up or were they clueless? Take a look.
Do you know what a fossil fuel is?
Yes.
What is it?
It's coal, gas, or coal, gas, or oil.
A fossil fuel is something that that's been there for generations, for millions of years, and dig it out of the ground.
Gas.
Coal. now you've got me. Coal.
and how about a greenhouse gas? Would you know any?
I'd say greenhouse gas would be like CFC, carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide.
Greenhouse gas, well, that's something that goes into our atmosphere and blocks all the sunlight from going outside our atmosphere.
And how about greenhouse gases? Can you name me any of them?
No, I don't think so.
OK, then, so we've got Lucy and Mark here. You watched that piece of tape there. Does that response and reaction surprise you?
It's better than I thought it would be, actually. Yeah. I'm encouraged by that, because there was some awareness of what these things mean, and we hear these referenced all the time. So until people can start thinking, what does that mean?
Well, you see, the thing is, you've got to make it simple for us, haven't you?
Yes.
So here we go, the definitive version of a greenhouse gas for us.
Oh, okay, here we go. Well, there's about 30 different greenhouse gases. Carbon dioxide is the one we talk about all the time, because that's a problematic one that we are spewing out in ever-increasing volume. And basically, they form a kind of blanket around the Earth's atmosphere. So the sun's rays, the solar radiation can get in, but the heat from the Earth can't escape. It's being absorbed by these different gases, and that gives us the greenhouse effect, which is problematic because the Earth is heating up.
Okay, all right, thank you for that. And Mark, what about fossil fuels?
Well, when we talk about fossil fuels, we're talking about coal, oil, and natural gas, basically. And the reason they're called fossil fuels is because they were made millions or hundreds of millions of years ago from the decomposed remains of prehistoric plants and animals. The reason they're in the news a lot is because when you burn fossil fuels, they release gases like carbon dioxide in particular, which is one of the greenhouse gases.
Okay, right. Thank you both very much indeed. Well, maybe everyone's found new knowledge now. It might prove useful later in the day. Annie.
Thank you, Philip. Zoe, you spent a day on the bins at Blue Peter. What did you learn from that?
Well, after we'd spent the day collecting all the rubbish, we went up to one of the recycling centres in Camden, and it was there that I discovered that it isn't just your typical household waste that you can recycle. For instance, there was an area specifically for eyewear and spectacles, so I literally had my eyes open to what you can recycle. I mean, there's 30 million tonnes of rubbish produced every year by households in the UK, and 50% of that can actually be recycled. So there's something that everyone in the UK can recycle to help the environment.
Good. How do you think you're doing in the test so far?
Oh, it is tricky. There's a couple of questions in there that I really didn't have a clue about. So
I think more than
easier.
A couple, Zoe.
Okay.
You're on 9 out of 21 correct at the moment.
Ooh, it's not great.
Julia.
I have less than that, surely.
I'll let you know in a second. Tell us about your experience of global warming.
Dull.
on honeymoon earlier on this year. I'm in Mexico having a lovely time. It was quite overcast, and I just thought, well, why would you need cream today? I only come from Australia where the big hole over the ozone layer is, and we use cream a lot, but I thought, not necessary. My husband Dan and I got so burnt that I'm not even joking, we couldn't even kiss each other on the lips for the rest of the holiday. And we couldn't even lie near each other because the heat from each other's bodies was so incredibly overbearing that I'm like, don't come near me, don't touch me. Apparently that's what it's like later in marriage. I didn't expect it to be like that on the honeymoon, so I had my own honeymoon nightmare.
Okay, and I'll let you know you've got 11 correct out of 21
well,
tonight.
Well, I'm sorry I'm so brainy, because I've been guessing every single one of those.
Now, Dick, you are seriously green, aren't you? You've got solar panels at home. You've insulated your roof with sheep's wool, is that right?
That's correct. And, I'm waiting for the punch here.
No. I just wanted you to tell us about a compost toilet you've got.
Absolutely. Well, we've tried to attack every aspect of our lives, and we still live in a 21st century way, but we are trying to make our own electricity, grow our own food, kill our own animals, so we're trying everything.
And most exciting for me is to learn that you've got hemp underpants.
Let's Sorry, ladies, that. This is true. Yes.
Come on, let's see. Let's see. Come on.
Oh, no. I have actually got, in fact, I'm wearing hemp except for my leather shoes.
Okay, and not only that, but you've answered every single question correctly up to now.
Impressive.
On with the test. Section three is called Man on Earth, starting with questions on physical geography. Do you know where places actually are? Six questions, 15 seconds to answer each. Question 22. Which of these is not in the Southern Hemisphere? Zimbabwe, the Falklands, India, Chile. Question 23, which country has the most coastline? Canada, China, Russia, Indonesia. Question 24, only one of the seven wonders of the world still exists. Where? Turkey, Egypt, Iraq, Greece. The can is which can stay? Brazil, Florida, Utah, California. Question 26. Which of these countries has the most Spanish speakers? Spain, Mexico, the USA, Brazil. Question 27. On this map of the world, which would be furthest north? North Korea, North Dakota, North Island, New Zealand, Northumberland. Moving on, the next five questions all feature celebrity explorers. Watch carefully, 15 seconds to answer each one. A clip first.
Uluru is one of the most historic sites in Africa. Sorry.
You're right.
It's a giant monolith, you know, it's as a single rock, and it's practically the geographical centre of Australia. And it's very sacred to the Aboriginal people. It's got great connections with their past and their stories of creation, which they call Dreamtime. And apparently men would travel for hundreds, possibly thousands of miles to come here to attend traditional ceremonies.
Question 28. Men behaving badly in the outback. By what name is Uluru also known? Is it Sugar Loaf Mountain, Ayers Rock, Table Mountain, or the Rock of Gibraltar?
The guy still wanted to take me big game hunting, and after four scorching hours of trekking, Gold finally spots a small antelope.
Back to my place, guinea fowl.
Question 29. That was Ian Wright with the famous Bushmen. From which desert? The Sahara, the Mojave, the Gobi, or the Kalahari?
At this point, all the world's lines of longitude converge on my toe caps. It's impossible to go further south than this. Every direction you go in will be north.
Question 30. Michael Palin had reached the South Pole. From there, how long would it take him to walk around the world? 8 seconds? 8 hours? 80 days? 8 months?
Did you see how fast that thing moved?
Imagine if that was in your pants.
It's always me who has to get them out of the bathroom or something. But this, I'm afraid I'd have to call the police if I saw this thing.
Question 31. Lenny Henry in the Amazon rainforest. Which spider was he afraid of? The funnel web, the tarantula, the redback, or the money spider?
I just feel that the place is important to me now. I feel that, you know, like the rainforest has Sting and now Siberia has Jack D. And obviously someone has to draw the short straw. And in this case, it's been the rainforest.
Question 32. Jack D was sent to Siberia, a region that makes up 50% of which country? Mongolia, China, Russia, Finland. Now, Ben, you're a celebrity explorer and you cross the Atlantic. Shall we have a look at a little bit of that? Can you talk us through it?
Yeah, basically, I set off with James Cracknell. We're naked there, you've probably noticed, very white bottoms. And it took us 49 days to row basically 3,000 miles.
What's his score?
It was sort of enjoyable now when I look back on it, but it wasn't at the time. And if I'd have known we were going to go naked, I might have chosen a pretty girl rather than a big hairy bloke, anyway.
I think you look gorgeous. Was it much tougher than you imagined?
It was, actually, yeah. I think we probably didn't do quite as much, or I didn't do quite as much planning and training as maybe I should have. But an amazing thing to say I've
and
done
you look
that.
Lovely, Ben.
Thank you.
Brian, not to be outdone, you have climbed Everest 3 times.
Yes, there's no end to my challenge.
No, I know.
It's been a wonderful experience. I think to me it was a kind of childhood dream, you know, that I read about these great explorers and this gigantic hunter. And I always wanted to go to the Northerns eventually and try and repeat Mallory's route.
Let's have a look.
Look at the mountain.
What mountain?
Yep. I feel that's the closest I've been to death.
Love the purple, Brian.
Yes.
Philip.
Thank you very much. Right, let's meet Clive Johnson, who's here. Clive, you had an expedition to the North Pole, and you got seriously into trouble.
Yes, quite foolishly. I was trying to walk to the North Pole, solo and unsupported, from Canada to the geographic north. Into the ice, we fell through some thin ice and...
Into the water?
Yes, up to my chest in water. And with the air temperature minus 65 degrees Celsius, that wasn't a very good idea. Fortunately, that time I was actually carrying an ice axe, which I don't normally do, which helped me to get out. Otherwise, I would have almost certainly have drowned.
So obviously, then, you are seriously into the realms of frostbite. What did it feel absolutely. Like when it began to creep up on you?
Well, after about 12 hours to try and get the boots thawed out and the boots off, the feet were just rock solid and severely frostbitten there. And
change colour?
Yeah, well, they go white first, like, you know, frozen fish, and then brown, and then mummified black.
And the Canadians were going to take them off, weren't they?
Yeah, I called for a removal by air and went back to Canada, and the first took the sign of and said, well, they've got to be amputated. So I thought, well, I get a second opinion on this, and went back home and saw my doctor, Dr. Saunders, who took it in as a kind of challenge because he'd never seen frostbite before.
Yes.
And with careful medication and dressing, he actually cured them, and I've still got my fingers and toes, yes.
Thank God for that. you got 25 out of 32 so far. And now we're going to explain and demonstrate what happened to you. Okay, because I'd like you to meet Brad here. Brad is from the Science Museum. He's what's called a punk scientist. And Brad, you're going to show us. Hello, mate. Nice to meet you. What happened there to his extremity?
cavities.
Serious explorer.
Frostbite is when your body's very clever. It sucks in all the heat from the extremities just to keep your core warm.
That's right. Serious exposure to serious cold, soft tissue, skin is going to start to crack and freeze. I'm going to show you how that works with some liquid nitrogen here. It's very cold, minus 196 degrees C. What I'm going to do is just put my fingers in here really quick, just to show you, like, oh, right on.
So frostbite, obviously you're speeding the process up quite
it's
a bit.
It's really
here.
Cold. It starts to sting right away. It starts to sting, cracking.
So the moisture within your hand now is freezing, forming ice crystals.
That's right. Yep.
Yeah. And those ice crystals now will start to burst through what the tissue is. Yep. Is that the sort of thing that happens? Once it gets to the point of no return, there's nothing you can do. No, they just managed to get his feet back, but other than that.
That's right. Yep. Here, I'll show you how this. Oh, let's have a look at these here. It looks as though they're pretty frozen.
Oh, yeah.
Solid there.
Yeah. That's it. That's terrific. Thanks very much indeed. But I won't shake your hand if that's all right. An experiment you can only do twice. Thanks very much indeed to Brad. Thank
you. And just to make it absolutely clear, they weren't really his fingers. And anyway, he's a trained punk scientist. Next, we're taking you around the world in 60 seconds. You need to listen very carefully as well as watch for clues, because in each case, you'll see the country's correct national flag, plus you'll hear their national anthem, some of which I might say are rather charming. 6 questions, 10 seconds to answer each. Question 33. Which European country is this? Switzerland, Belgium, France, or Germany? Question 34. Which African country is this? Kenya, Nigeria, Cameroon, Ivory Coast? Question 35. Which of India's neighbours is this? Nepal, Pakistan, Burma, Bangladesh? Question 36. Which Asian country is this? South Korea, North Korea, Taiwan, Japan? Question 37. Which South American country is this? Uruguay, Chile, Paraguay, Brazil? Question 38. Which British island is this? Jersey, Alderney, Guernsey, the Isle of Wight? And if you thought some of those national anthems were...
Thank you, that's enough.
Apologies to any visiting Algerians. And that's the end of section 3. Philip.
Thanks very much, Annie. We quite liked that, didn't we?
Yeah, it was very
reasonable national anthem, the Algerians. Of course, as the world gets smaller, our taste for travel gets larger, our travel stories get more and more extraordinary. And you went to Zimbabwe, didn't you?
That's right, yes. I went off to Zimbabwe and stayed on a tiny island in the middle of Lake Kariba. And there I had a rather exciting thing happen. Mm. We had to get back to the main shore, which was about an hour away, and went in a tiny boat with 2 other tourists. We had to be very careful. There were loads of hippo and buffalo around. And in fact, a tourist had been killed by a buffalo just a few days before I got there. Mm. Anyway, we set off, and about sort of 15 minutes in, the boat ran out of petrol. So the driver sort of thought, well, we'll have to paddle back to the island, which we started to do, trying to avoid the hippo. We'd gone a short while, and then suddenly the boat became totally engulfed with this massive rain cloud, and we couldn't see anything at all.
You were bailing it out with your shoes, weren't you?
Well, yes, it was. The boat soon started to fill up.
So how did you think you were going to die?
Yes, fairly close to, because the hippo were very, very close, and they all had young, so of course
so
it was quite dangerous.
Terrified to go in the water.
Very worried,
and
yes.
Miraculously, the clouds cleared, the sun came out just before the boat went down.
Just before the boat went down, yes, and we finished bailing out and very quietly paddled away from this hippo. So.
And you lived to come here this evening.
And we came back here. Yes.
27 out of 38 you've got so far.
Oh,
well done to
much.
You. Terrific. Melanie went to Turkey.
I did, yes.
You ended up in an interesting event.
Indeed, yes, it was fascinating. I was very unwell, actually, and having a day of rest. And looking out across the village, the place was just alive with this convoy of traffic, men in fezes and ornate dress, driving through, beeping, and it was absolute chaos.
Busy Turkey day.
Very busy. So yes. After hours of this, I asked what was going on, and a young lad said, "Come, I show. And he took me by the hand, led me through this maze of streets. And we found this garden with lots of people eating, men eating in the garden. And he led me through, shoes off, pushed me through a hole in the wall, and I ended up in a home full of ladies, three young boys who'd just had the procedure and had walked into a Turkish circumcision ceremony.
And you were the guest of honour?
I was, yes.
Yes, you wouldn't want to tuck into their finger buffet, though, would you?
Well, I was offered lots of local delicacies.
Well, I bet you were. Have we got your score? Let's see if we've got your score, actually. We're on our computer upstairs. Felix, you've got... Oh, do you want to know your score? It's not huge. It's 11 out of 38. What do you mean you've got trouble with that? I'll sit here and show you how it works, Ellie.
Thank you very much. Lucy, talking about countries around the world, who's good at being green? Which countries set a good example?
Well, most of the developing world countries use a tiny fraction of the resources that we need here. In terms of Europe, the UK has always been very bad at recycling traditionally. Switzerland's very good. They've got draconian recycling fines.
And why doesn't that surprise us?
Yeah. Scandinavian countries are very good. They've got the biofuels, renewable energy, that kind of thing. Yeah. In the UK, we kind of use about three planets worth of resources at the moment, but this is getting worse. America, very bad. They use about five planets worth of resources per person, so we don't want to emulate that trend.
Okay, so we're better than America?
Slightly.
Yeah, good. Mark, with all your photographing around the world, if you had to choose how to die at the hands of a wild animal, what would it be?
Gosh, there are so many possibilities. I think, for me, the worst way to go would be thanks to... There's a tiny little fish called a kangaroo fish that's about the length of your little finger.
Yeah.
I can hear some murmurs over there.
They know about it.
Yeah, they know about it. And it's translucent.
Yeah.
It lives in South America.
Yeah.
And it's in rivers like the Amazon. So if you're in the Amazon River having a pee, which you do if you travel to those sort of places, you can't see it coming, and it goes up the urine. And if you're a man, it goes into your willy.
Yeah.
And you can't get it out because a whole load of spines, like a little mini umbrella, suddenly shoot out and it wedges itself in there.
So, Philip, next time you're swimming in the Amazon.
Yeah, we've both got our legs crossed here. Yeah, great story. And then if you've ever wondered what it is like to be mauled by a wild animal and you've never appeared on The Weakest Link, then... Brad is going to explain now. Brad, the power in an animal's jaws is extraordinary. Take, for instance, something like a parrot or a macaw.
Okay, that's like a two-punch lunch. You've got one hand, you've got the PSI, the pounds per square inch, of the actual bite, the teeth coming down, right? Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, you've got the actual size and power of the animal itself. So let's say a macaw or a parrot, some kind of a wild bird, might have a bite, a PSI
of
maybe...
Before you do it, let's just show that there's no trickery here. Okay,
no, there's no trickery
fine.
Here.
Right, okay, this is the power in a parrot's beak.
Right, about 300, 350 pounds per square inch, which is the same as this roofing gun.
Okay.
Like that.
So that's going to sting if it bites you. Yeah,
that's not going to feel very
nasty
good.
Nasty peck. All right, well, let's ratchet it up now. Have a look at this. Now that is a mouth that is built to kill, isn't it?
We're talking 3,000 pounds per square inch. We can't really do that right here, but I've got to...
Let me show you something. This, if you were in the Amazon, in a little pond, a little pool, this is your leg. Ah, there you are. Right, OK, so explain to me how the jaws of a croc work.
Well, I found a fun little toy to explain how that works and show the audience how this works. This is a fun little, toy we've got
here. On the politicians here behind you.
Yeah. Basically, what we've got is we've got our biting like this, and we've got our tearing and ripping sort of like this, and what we can do is just kind of grab onto it and give it a good bite like that. Oh.
And that's what it does.
Pretty much.
There you go. That use of this is just like Prime Minister's Question Time. Well done, Brad. Thank you very much indeed. Another great experiment.
A bit like cosmetic surgery. On with the test of Section 4. We call this the Living Planet, and we've included some quirky animal facts, plus an odd one out round. The first six questions come under the heading Fact or Fiction. 20 seconds to answer each question. Question 39. Which of these would you not find in the Arctic with the polar bear? Lemming, reindeer, penguin, walrus.
By early December, the residents of Christmas Island wake up to find crabs on their doorsteps. To some, it may seem like a living nightmare, but most people here carry on regardless and have learned to work around the invasion of these crustaceans, which you can't even eat.
Question 40. Why do these crabs cross Christmas Island? Is it to breed, to die, to feed, or to holiday? Question 41. Which of these does not exist? The walking bat, the flying frog, the fish-eating spider, the tree-climbing ostrich?
Oh, Mother rang. She wants to know if we're going over to see her on Sunday. Reggie?
Yes, of course I'm listening. What?
I said, do you mind if we go over and see Mother on Sunday? Do you mind?
No, of course not. I don't see the hippo first, the first thing. Go and see your mother.
Question 42. What's the correct term for a female hippopotamus? Cow, mare, sow, mother-in-law?
They live in the rain-drenched forest of the Amazon and run in a strict order. The females in front headed by the most senior, the males following obediently behind. They prefer wet country around the banks of the numerous rivers, but they're not common anywhere.
Question 43. What sort of animal is the South American bush dog? A cat, a bear, a weasel, or a dog? Question 44. Why is the frog making that noise? To attract a mate, to scare off an aggressor, to warn other frogs of danger, or because someone stood on his toe? And continuing with Section 4, the odd one out round. You have to be very quick here. Eight questions, but only 10 seconds for each one. Question 45. Which of these doesn't have young called cubs? The beaver, the lion, the bear, or the tiger?
Question 46. Which of these ocean dwellers is not a fish? The shark, the mudskipper, the stingray, the starfish. Question 47. Only one of these birds can fly. Which is it? The penguin, the kiwi, the puffin, the emu. Question 48. Three of these can be poisonous to humans. Which can't? The foxglove, lily of the valley, the rhododendron, the dandelion. Question 49. Which of these is a marsupial? The wolf, the possum, the hyena, the human. Question 50. Which of these does not have a beak? The dolphin, the giraffe, the octopus, the turtle. Question 51. Which of these doesn't eat meat? The duck, the koala, the skunk, the raccoon. Question 52. Which of these animals is not a monkey? The chimp, the capuchin, the baboon, the Barbary ape. Now, that's the end of section four, and there's just one more section to go. Philip.
Thank you. I've got Rod and Jay here, both builders. How do you think you're doing this evening so far, builders?
Brilliant.
Yes, sir. Oh, a little bit of that going. Okay. You guys actually are making a bid for chart success.
We are indeed. We've written a song for England's up-and-coming World Cup.
Uh-huh. And when and where did you write this?
I wrote it last year on the building site with the lads.
What were you building at the time?
I can't remember, to be honest.
Building someone's house?
I think we was.
You wrote a song whilst you were building someone's house?
We did, yeah. Okay. I played it to the lads and they all said it was really good, so we decided to go in and record it in a professional studio.
And you've paid for sort of any favours that were done by PR companies and things by building what?
Conservatories, kitchens and all sorts of stuff like that.
Well, let's have a look at it. We'll let our audience in here be the... First of all, let's find out whether or not you think it's any good in the studio. Yes or no, yeah? Yes, and that's good. That's very good.
Thank you.
Now let's find out from our celebs what they think, OK? Hit or miss, celebs?
Oh, yeah.
It's across the board, it's a hit! Well done, guys.
Thanks.
Annie.
Definite number one. Now, this is the final section of Know Your Planet, questions about the future of the planet and how we can help to protect it. To begin, questions concerning the British Isles. Six of them, 15 seconds to answer each.
Hedgehogs, also in decline in the countryside, are now doing well closer to home. If not treated with pesticides, a suburban garden has three times as many earthworms as the same area of ploughed field. And hedgehog families travel far at night in search of the tastiest morsels.
Question 53. What should you not feed hedgehogs? Worms, pet food, chopped peanuts, bread and milk? Question 54. Which is the most common songbird in the UK? The crow, the blackbird, the wren, or Charlotte Church?
In 1986, the Giant's Causeway was designated a World Heritage Site by the United Nations. It was granted this status partly because the struggle to understand how this strange landscape was formed helped to give birth to the science of geology.
Question 55. Where in the British Isles would you find the Giant's Causeway? England, Wales, Scotland, or Northern Ireland? Question 56. Which of these animals has made its home in and around Loch Lomond? The sloth, the baboon, the wallaby, the wild haggis?
Two months ago, we reported on the amazing appearance of several hundred sharks off the Devon and Cornish coast. They were so accessible that you could watch them from the beach, from cliff tops, or from even in the water. Just look at that. That's fantastic.
Question 57. This is the largest shark found in British waters. Which is it? The hammerhead, the tiger, the great white, or the basking? Question 58. How many islands make up Great Britain? 1,147, 2,247, 5,547, or 7,747?
This is rubbish, this. It's the biggest load of crap I've ever seen. What's on the other side?
Question 59. Every hour the UK produces enough household rubbish to fill what? A skip, a double-decker bus, a family home, the Albert Hall. Now, a last chance for everyone to shine. The final six questions, they're about the future of our planet. 20 seconds to answer each one. Question 60. Coldplay have tried to carbon neutralise their latest album by doing what? Planting new trees, recycling water, reducing noise, or reusing vinyl? Question 61. Fuel cell buses help to reduce pollution and noise. What do they run on? Helium, coal, hydrogen, solar power?
You seen the price of these spuds?
Yeah. Well, you pay the extra because they're organic. I tell you, there's no E120 additives in these foods.
E120s? What are you talking about? E120s. Before you met Cassandra, you thought an E120 was a bus.
Question 62. Which of these claims about organic food is not true? Free from chemicals, conserves soil, genetically modified, supports animal welfare? Question 63. George Clooney made the news last year for getting what? An all-electric car, a home wind turbine, a wormery, drunk with Brad Pitt? Question 64. Which of these could be used as a greener fuel for cars? Horse manure, compost, cooking oil, hamster droppings?
So then God created the world, and the first day he created light and air and fish. Cuts and arguments and small things and rabbits and people with noses and jam, more jam perhaps. And tobogganing and showers and toasters and grandmothers and Belgium and...
Question 65. That was Eddie Izzard's theory on the Earth's creation. Which of these has he made an advertisement for? Friends of the Earth, Greenpeace, Comic Relief, the World Wide Fund for Nature?
And that is the end of the Know Your Planet test. Well done, everybody. I think you all deserve a round of applause. And a thank you all for all those who played interactively. Your score's coming up shortly. Everyone else will have to wait for theirs until part two, when I'll be giving you the answers.
Also in part two, we'll find out how well our studio groups have done, how well they know their planet. Did our explorers... defeat the school-run mums? Did the politicians overcome the cyclists? Maybe the weather forecasters got one over on the builders? Did any of them run rings around our celebrities? And how did you do? There are our very eager celebs wanting to know how they did. We will, of course, tell you, if you played online, your results a little bit later on. We'll tell you which of the nation knows our planets the best. Is it the Scots, the English, the Welsh or the Irish? And will the men beat the women again?
And also, would you like to be a member of one of our studio groups for our next show? Because Philip's got the details.
Do you want to be part of our studio audience in the next IQ test in September? Are you a butcher, a public school student, a state school student, a vegetarian, a footballer's wife, or an estate agent? If you fit into one of these groups, then Test the Nation needs you. Call this free phone number, leaving your name and daytime telephone number 0800 043 3456, or visit our website at bbc.co.uk/testthenation to download an application form.
It's a great night. We'd love you to come and join us. The only qualification is to be over 16, and if you